Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
So when Brother Mark told me that I have to speak on the topic of growing in God's Word, I was happy because it's an easy topic. But today when I started preparing for the talk, I realized that I am giving to a group of praise and worship team, and you are so much in the Word of God. What new thing can I tell you about the Word of God and about growing in the Word of God? You have already grown so much and growing so much in the Word of God. What can I contribute? Anyway, I have compiled a few things. Most of this may be familiar to you, but maybe one or two things I can give you new, and I'll be happy if I can do that for you. I'll start off by asking you to think of all the people who are there in your life now. No, you can think of your when you think about that, you'll be thinking about your parents, brothers and sisters, siblings, children, neighbors, friends, office colleagues. So many people are there in our life, but one person who's there in our life who is more alive and active than all these people is the Word of God. Correct, na? We are getting this from Hebrews 4:12, which says, "For the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of the soul, of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intention of the heart." The Word of God is so powerful in our lives. It is more alive than all of us, and it acts in our life. Nothing is hidden from God. God knows our deepest emotions, our hopes, what we want, what we don't want, what we like. There are many things which we don't know about ourselves, which the Word of God knows, which God knows. It knows our past, but it knows our future also. That's why when we turn to the Bible guides us. It tells us things which is useful for us, which will help us in our problem at that time. That is why the Word of God is so important. But for that, we have to approach the Word of God. We have to read the Bible. Correct, na? Okay. Now, there are two things. When we pray to God, we are talking to God. You know, when we pray to God, normally we have some problem, some sorrow, something which we want sorted in our life, so we approach God. Yes, sometimes we approach God when we want to thank the Lord, when we want to, we did so much praise and worship, na? So we do this also. But all this is one-way communication. We are talking to the Lord, but we don't know what God is telling us. Correct, na? So when will we know what God is telling us? God does talk to us in our silences. When we are, thinking of deep in meditation, at that time God talks to us. But God most probably talks to us when we are reading the scriptures. When we are reading the Bible, God is definitely talking to us. See, when we, when we get insights about God, ki God told me this, God came to me, yeah, that is true. But sometimes we may be projecting our desires, our fears, and we may be thinking that is the Word of God. A sure way of knowing what the Word of God is approaching the scriptures, the Bible. That is why Saint Ambrose of Milan says, ki when we pray, we talk to the God, we talk to God, but when we read the Bible, God talks to us. And that is what we want sometimes, no? Because, okay, we pray, but God also wants to talk to us. We love God, but God loves us more than we love Him. That is why He wants to tell us things, He wants to guide us, He wants to do good things for us. And all that He can do if we are able to listen to Him. That is why we must approach the Bible, read it. We do read the Bible, in the church the readings are there. These kind of talks we do come across the Word of God. But the best thing is to sit, find time and daily do a good reading of the Bible. Now, to imprint more that God is there in the Bible, God can be found in the Bible, let us go to this that Emmaus experience. You all know about the Emmaus experience, na? After लॉर्ड जीसस वॉज क्रूसिफाइड, टू डिसाइपल्स वर वॉकिंग टूवर्ड्स इमाउस एंड देन जीसस क्राइस्ट अप्रोच देम बट दे डोंट रिकग्नाइज जीसस. जीसस आस्क देम व्हाट दे आर टॉकिंग अबाउट जीसस बट दे बट व्हेन जीसस कम्स दे डोंट रिकग्नाइज हिम बिकॉज दे डोंट हैव फेथ कि जीसस मे हैव रिजन. सो दे आर ब्लाइंड टू दिस कि इट इज जीसस हु इज देयर विद देम. जीसस आस्क देम एंड देन ही एंड दे टेल हिम इट्स अबाउट जीसस. देन जीसस रेप्रिमांड्स देम कि इट इज देयर इन द स्क्रिप्चर्स दैट ही विल राइज अगेन, व्हाई आर यू सो वरीड. And then they invite him for dinner, and then when Jesus breaks the bread, their eyes are open and they can see Jesus. They know it is Jesus. They recognize him, and then Jesus disappears. And then they say something very telling. They say, when Jesus is explaining to them, it says in Luke 24:27, and beginning with Moses and the prophets, he revealed to them things about himself in the scriptures. Now scriptures at that time was the Old Testament. So it says ki he revealed things about himself in the scriptures, means even in the Old Testament Jesus is there. Definitely is there in the New Testament, but also he is there in the Old Testament. So when we approach the scriptures, we find Jesus in the scriptures, correct na? And then when Jesus has disappeared, what do they say? Were not our hearts burning within us while he was opening the scriptures to us, while he was talking to us? So when we encounter Jesus in the scriptures, our hearts burn, something happens to us. There is a change. Now there are a few points which we can note from this experience. First and foremost is, initially when Jesus came, they could not recognize him because they did not have faith in him. Okay, now as Jesus expounds the scriptures to them, as he reveals himself, all the things pertaining to himself in the scriptures, their eyes get opened. They are not fully opened until he breaks the bread, and then they recognize Jesus because the scriptures were open to them. Jesus is there in the scriptures. Then after they find Jesus in the scriptures, he disappears. Because they have found Jesus in the scriptures, no need for Jesus to be physically present. Amazing, na? One more example. Saint Thomas, doubting Thomas, what does he say when the disciples tell him ki Jesus came to us physically, we met him, we saw his wounds and all? He says, unless I see his wounds and I touch his wounds, only then I will believe him. And then Jesus comes. And then of course he believes him, says, my Lord and my God. And then what does Jesus say? You see and you believe, but blessed are those who have not seen me and yet believe. We are those people. We have not seen Jesus physically, but we believe because we find him in the scriptures. This is the importance of the scriptures. This is the importance of reading the scriptures, because Jesus is there. And it is so amazing that it is there for us anytime to go pick up the books and read. But we have to read with faith. We have to believe God is there. We have to believe ki we will find our help. We will find whatever we need in the scriptures, in the books. And that is what we have to cultivate. That faith in God. And how does this faith come? Faith comes by, we all know this, faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. We have that in Romans. Now, the best thing we can do about increasing our faith in the word of God is to see examples of our Old Testament heroes in the scriptures. So we'll start with Noah. At the time when Noah was living, it says in the Bible ki the whole world was corrupt. Only evil thoughts were coming in the minds of the people. They thought only evil, they did only evil, and God was so disgusted that he wanted to end the world. And among all these disgusting people, all these evil people, Noah was a righteous one. He believed in God, he walked in God. He believed the promise that God gave to Adam, that the seed of the woman will destroy the serpent. He believed this, he kept this in his mind, and he was righteous. And then when God said ki a flood will come and destroy the earth, he believed that. Now they were living in a desert, there was no conception of flooding of the world, but still he believed because God told him. And according to scholars, building of the ark was not an overnight job. They say it must have taken 20 to 40 years. For 20 to 40 years he was building the ark, every day believing a flood will come. People must have scorned him, they were evil people. Everything must have gone against him. Everybody must have scolded him. Ki, what are you doing? 20 years you are building the ark, 30 years still you are building the ark. But he believed in God. He knew ki what God said will come true. That much faith he had. And then when the flood came, he was able to save mankind. Otherwise there will be no man, no? All of us would have gone. One man's faith could save all mankind. That is the power of believing in the word of God. Let's go to Abraham. Abraham was already well settled. He was even old at the time when God came to him. He was living in Ur. He had his own house. He had his family. Generations of people were living there, but God called him, come with me. He went. He didn't know what will happen to him. Whom will he encounter? But he said, God said, I will give you land. I will give land to you and your descendants. And he believed that. Eventually the Israelites got land when Moses brought them. Although he was staying there, he didn't own that land. No, he lived only in that area, and there were other people living. It was not belonging to his. He was not the king of that place. They got land when Moses brought them to the promised land. Joshua conquered Canaan. Only then they got the land. The promise was fulfilled. God promised him that the nations will be blessed through him. That promise is still getting fulfilled. Now billions of people are Christians, but more will turn not to Christ, and then Abraham will become their father and they will be blessed because of him, like how we are being blessed through him. That is the power of faith in Abraham. Not only his God fulfilled his promises to Abraham when Abraham was alive, but he is fulfilling them even now. And that is the power of Abraham's faith in the word of God. God told him, walk with me. He walked with him. Moses had murdered an Egyptian. He was such a hot-headed man. He murdered, and in order to escape the death sentence, he went to Midian, and there he settled down. Actually, he married Zipporah and he was living there comfortably until God met him in the burning bush, and God said, go back to Pharaoh, face him. Now he need not have gone there because he was already well off, doing well. He was married to the chieftain's daughter Zipporah, doing all very well. But God said go, he went, and because he kept God's word, he was able to bring God's people to the promised land. This is what faith in God's word can do. You can change the destiny of a nation. Forget about solving our own problems, but we can change destinies. When they were going, when they had crossed the Red Sea and they were about to attack Canaan, they sent 12 spies. And then the spies came back and they told him, what did they tell him? That it is a land flowing with milk and honey. The fruits are great, the trees are great, the houses are great, but it is very dangerous for us to attack. I'm talking about Joshua and Caleb. Huh? It is very dangerous to attack them because they are much stronger than us. There are giants there. Their villages are fortified. They have better weapons, everything. We should not go there. We will be killed. But Caleb says, we should go up and take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it. How did he think that they can do it when everybody else says ki we cannot do it? People were against him. And at that time, he and Joshua, they tore their clothes. They said, no, we have to attack. What did they say? The land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will lead us into the land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and he will give it to us. Only do not rebel against the land and do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will devour them. We will devour them means we will kill and eat them. Itna usko power, itna matlab, he had so much faith that we will not even destroy, we will kill and eat. I mean, figure of speech, but that is the power Joshua and Caleb had, whereas those people were so much stronger, so much well fortified, still they had this faith. Why did they have this faith? Because they say their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them. They knew that the Lord is with them, and as long as the Lord is with us, we don't have to worry about anything. That is the faith they had. And then the people did not go, did not attack. So God said, I will punish everybody else. Those about 20 will not see the promised land. They will die in the wilderness. Only Joshua and Caleb were saved. 40 years later, they took the people of God to Israel. And Caleb got a good inheritance. Joshua was the leader. And that's how not only they but their descendants also enjoyed the fruits of their faith. They were so had, they had so much faith that God will take care of them. Now we'll turn to David and Goliath. He is one man whose faith we have to speak of. And only by dwelling in the Bible and reading about the faith of our leaders can we also develop our faith. Faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. That's what we are doing. We are hearing the word of God and we are developing our faith. And this faith will change our destiny. Correct? Now you all believe that?
Yes.
David was not even old enough to join the army. He was young. His elder brothers were there in the army. He was grazing the sheep. And sometimes he used to take food for his brothers. And at that time, during the story, the Israelites were fighting the Philistines, and the Philistines gave them a unique proposition. They said, "Ki, we have one person, Goliath. If any of you bring anybody, if they can destroy, if they can defeat Goliath, we accept defeat. We will become your slaves. Otherwise, if Goliath is able to defeat your person, then you all have to become our slaves." The Israelites were so terrified of Goliath because Goliath was a giant. They were so terrified. When they saw him, they used to run. Forget about fighting with him. They couldn't even face him eye to eye. From a distance. Dur se dekha bhagi. This was the fear they had. And Goliath used to come daily and berate them, scold them, curse them. Come and fight with me. Come and fight me. They would not fight with him. They didn't know what to do. And one day when David goes to give food, he sees Goliath. And what does he say? What does he say about Goliath, the person of whom they are afraid of? He says, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" Amazing. Everybody is running around scared, and he's saying, "Who is this Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" He knew ki the Israelite army is powerful because it is the army of the living God. And their king was Saul. Saul is in such a state ki people are attacking me, nobody is willing to defend. He is even able to consider David that he can fight Goliath. So he calls David. And then when he sees David, he is also worried ki David cannot defend Israel. He cannot fight. So he gives up hope and he says, "How will you fight him? You are so young. He is so strong. He is doing battle for so many years. Jitna tumhara umar hai, utna to usne fight kiya hai." But what does David say? David says, "Your servant has killed both lion and bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them. He may be a lion, he may be a bear. But because he has defied the armies of the living God, the Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of the Philistine." He is so confident. The king of that country is telling him, "Don't go to fight." He says, "I will fight him because God will rescue me. Don't worry, king. This Philistine is nothing. Maine bear ko mara hai, inko bhi maar dega." Then Saul gives him his armor. "You wear this armor. At least thoda to bachega tu." He says, "I don't want this armor because it will hinder my this. He only takes a sling and stones. And then when Goliath sees ki one boy has come to fight, he becomes angry and starts cursing him. Who has sent you? Why did you come? You think I'm a dog that you have come to me with sticks? Then David tells him, you come against me with sword and spear and javelin, 3-3-4-4 weapons, and I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty. They have weapons, he has got name of the Lord. The God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands. I'll strike you down and cut off your head. This giant is standing in front of him, who everybody is up. He is saying, no fear, no fear. A giant khada hai, there is no fear in him. He is saying, I'll cut off your head. Look at that boy. Hai na? Amazing. This very day I'll give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals. Bapre. And the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. The world will know there is a God in Israel. Now when we have problems, do we think like that? There is a problem, huh? Kuch toh hua hai. What is our reaction? Do we think that we are children of a living God? And we can defeat this problem easily. Do we look at that problem in the eye and say, ki, I can defeat you, mere paas God hai. Can we say that? Huh? This is the faith of David. Let's see what he says further. All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves. Lord doesn't save by sword or spear. How does he save? For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands. Lord will take care. Lord doesn't have to give me a sword. He doesn't have to give me a spear. He will take care. I don't have to worry so much. This should be our attitude when we are faced with problems. Okay? Because we have the word of God. We are confident. Okay, the more and more we are into the word of God, the more and more God will take care of us. It will be our guide. It will be our sure, a surety of success. So, because of his faith, he was able to build an empire and he never lost a battle. We know that. He never lost a battle and he defeated the Philippines to such an extent that in the entire history of Israel afterwards, there were no Philistines. That was his greatness. Now, we also have many Goliaths in our lives. We have, you know, some of us have a job. Job mein stress hai. These are the Goliaths. Relationship problems. Brother is not talking. Father is angry with me. Stress in the work. And how do we fight the Goliaths in our lives? We try our own tricks. No? We try to do this. But the most important thing we should do is rely on the word of God. Stand in faith. Have the word of God. Declare the word of God and say, this is going to protect me. Now, in Matthew, it says ki when God takes care of even the birds in the air, why will he not take care of me? Seek first the kingdom of God. Our focus should be on the kingdom of God. Everything else will fall in place. That's what he says now. God says, I will never forsake you. He's always there for us. When we have this word of God so strong in our lives, nothing can go wrong. That is the faith we should have. Ephesians tell us to wear the armor of God. You know, when we approach the world and when we get all this kind of advice, our faith improves. We become stronger and stronger in faith. We don't know what we can achieve with this faith. Now, when Jesus was fasting in the desert for 40 days, Satan came to tempt him. Jesus used scripture. He didn't say anything other than scripture. Huh? All the three attempts of temptation and three answers of Jesus, they are all from Deuteronomy. When Jesus used scripture against Satan, we can also use scripture against Satan. Now, we should have that much knowledge of scripture. We should absorb scripture so much in our lives that words are always in our heart. The scripture is floating. Always. Deep inside our, in the spirit of spirit, there is scripture. words of God are there in our heart. When we think in terms of the Bible, what God has told us, things will change. Psalm 119 is the longest chapter in the Bible. It has got how many? 176 verses. Each of those verses talks about the Word of God. Word of God is referred to in all the 176 verses. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey in my mouth. For us also, the Word of God should be sweet, sweeter than honey in our mouths. Life will change. What happens when we don't have the Word of God? Hosea, 700 years before Christ, he said, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Lack of knowledge of Word of God can destroy us. We are getting destroyed, na? Problems. See, we lose when we lose in our minds. When we have the Word of God, we have faith, confidence. Because of this faith, confidence, guidance of God, Holy Spirit, we can surpass anything. But when we don't have knowledge, na, ki God is there with us, God is not forsaking us, He has written our names in the palm of His hand. So many beautiful things are there. It's full of treasure. We have to own all that. Then nobody can defeat us. Jesus says, the words I speak to you are spirit and they are life. They are. They are spirit and life. Nothing can touch us if we have the Word of God with us. Jesus says, if a man loves me, he will keep my word. If we love God, we'll keep His word. We have to know the words, huh? Then only we can keep it. And my Father will love him. And we will come and make our home with him. Matlab, he will come and stay with us in our houses, in our hearts. If we love God, we'll keep His word and God will come and stay with us. Amazing, huh? Yes. The word of God is there for us to read and all, but sometimes we don't understand everything about the Word of God. There are some difficult passages. In fact, there are many difficult passages. Some parables we don't understand. Some sentence. That is why we have this Bible study class. We are doing this. We are lucky that we have it in the Rosary Church. I humbly request everyone to join this Bible class. Thanks.